So, yeah, so there will be some things that I am not looking forward to reliving, and knowing what feelings I engendered in another person by my actions. And for that reason, we're not on after effects yet, but when we get to them, the life review is probably the most impactful aspect of the near-death experience, other than just the experience of continuing to exist when my body might be even, for example, in cardiac arrest, and knowing that my consciousness is vivid and clear and this is absolutely real. That's why people come back knowing, as Audrey said, not just believing, but knowing that that consciousness survives physical death. But the other big thing is the life review. And people really talk about making very conscious decisions in their subsequent life, knowing that they're going to relive this moment in their life review. So it has a big impact on people's life choices and how they treat other people. So, we don't know what the prevalence of NDEs is. That means how many people sometime in their life experience near-death experience. But we do know that from research that approximately 1 in 5 people who survives a close brush with death will report a near-death experience. Now, the experience can be relatively shallow or relatively deep, and I don't mean a value judgment. It's just shallow is a word to describe few features that aren't very intense. And some people have a lot of features that are very intense. And so the most widely used instrument to assess near-death experiences is the near-death experience scale. And it measures the presence and the depth of a near-death experience. And that comes into play when we move on to after effects, that the deeper an NDE, the more intense the after effects are likely to be. At the same time, I've known people who had a relatively quote-unquote shallow experience but still have some pretty profound after effects. So there's a relationship there, but like many things, it's not, you know, a direct one-to-one relationship. So let's see what else we have here. Oh yeah, so Tricia. I interviewed her in 2008. At the time, she was in her mid-30s, a community college English teacher, fully physically functional, as you'll see. She grew up in an evangelical church in Texas. She described that she pretended to participate in the church. It was her social world, so she went along with it, even though she didn't really buy into the worldview. When she was a college student around the age of 20, she would, and back when 1994, 14 years before the interview, she was going to school at the University of Texas at Austin, and she was 21 years old. She described herself as having an unclear career purpose. She knew she was good in English, and the most she'd ever thought about work was maybe she'd become a copy editor. But she really said she was actually too self-absorbed to even think about her future work life. She just described herself as very self-centered. She got up early one morning to run a 10K, and she remembers being sleepy, and then the next thing she knew, she regained consciousness in the hospital. She had had a terrible car accident. She broke her back in 3 places. She had multiple fractures in her legs. And the physicians told her family that they needed to prepare themselves that she would never walk again. So that night, she went into surgery. And during the surgery, she went into cardiac arrest. She obviously was resuscitated. And she spent 6 months in a full body cast while her back healed. So she went through a lot physically. Now we're going to hear what she experienced psychologically during her NDE.
So what's the first thing that you remember from the once you were anesthetized, I guess?
Yeah, I counted back to 98, and then, sorry, I remember those numbers, but then I woke up, as I call it, so, you know, but I left my body, and before the monitor, said, or before the monitor registered that I was dead, I had already left my body. And so I looked down at my body, and then I saw the monitor flatline. And then I looked outside of myself, almost afraid on some level, but there were two beings at the end of my bed, and they immediately calmed me, because they had, these beings were large, like maybe 7 or 8 feet, and androgynous, not particularly male or female. But the first thing I thought when I saw them is, wow, they are so intelligent. They have an intelligence that I don't think we have here. And they communicated through their eyes, basically with light. And I was surprised that I continued to go on. I mean, that was like my first real realization, was that, okay, outside of my body, I do continue. And I wanted to return and tell other people, hey, we do go on. You know, that it was so exciting, you know, that thought that we do. But these beings were sending messages to me at a very quick rate of speed. And so I knew that a lot of information was being communicated to me. And how they communicated to me that I would walk and that I would heal is that they sent light, they sent it into my spirit form and said, then watch this. And then they looked at my body and sent light into my body, into the backs of the surgeons, through their hands, into my body. And I just saw the light fill my body, and I knew, okay, my back would heal, I would walk again, and that everything would be fine. And then they said, continue. And so I started leaving the hospital, and it felt as if I decided I didn't want to look at my body anymore at that point, and you know, that the blood and the surgeons and so forth, it didn't seem like a situation or a scene that I wanted to spend time with. So I decided I would leave, and I started leaving the hospital quickly. I left the emergency room, the first couple of doors, and then I went through the waiting room and saw my mom, and then I kept going down the hall and I saw my stepdad. And this is the one situation that makes my near-death experience verifiable. I saw him dropping quarters into a machine, and he pulled out a candy bar. And my parents had only been married for a short time. My mom and stepdad, my parents had been divorced for a few years, and I didn't know him very well, but what I knew of him, I knew that he was a health nut, and that, you know, both my mom and stepdad never ate candy bars. If they did, you know, it must have been, you know, in secrecy. And so I saw him getting this candy bar, and I thought, that's strange. And then I continued on and just flew through the walls of the hospital, and then started going into the sky of Austin and, you know, looked down at the city. And then continued, and then the scene changed. It was no longer just Austin or the physical reality where I had been, because they started operating at 7 at night, and or around 8 at night. The accident had occurred at 7 in the morning. And so it was nighttime, but then at some point it became day. There was a bright light, and I was going back in time, so having a small bit of a life review. And what I realized, or what the light wanted me to see, was that other people who I came in contact with had been affected by my presence. And what they wondered is, why does this girl stay completely absorbed in herself? Why doesn't she reach out to us? Why doesn't she tell us what's going on in her life? Why is she not more of a friend to us or more open? And so I realized that I had been harming not only myself by not having a connection with other people, but perhaps disappointing other people by not having much of a connection with them. And so I realized that connections with other people make life more meaningful. So that was one of the first lessons. And then another lesson, they seemed to be crystallized in thoughts. The lessons were not given to me from the light with words per se, but they were feelings. And then in my own mind, I created lines or thoughts that seemed to crystallize what the experience was trying to tell me. And one is not to fear death, you know, that there is no fear in death, you know, that it is a beautiful, natural experience. And two, that our connections to other people are important, and that perhaps even love is all that matters, you know, that the love that you do experience with other people is what makes your life meaningful. And then also, I think many adults, I went back to about the age of 5 at a time when I loved to play in nature and when I was very connected to the natural world, and I didn't have very much stress in my life. And I think that another lesson that the light was telling me at that moment was, people are too stressed out. They don't know how to enjoy themselves, how to play, or how to be in nature. So it's important to remind people to enjoy life, you know, to have moments of beauty in their world and in their life. And often that can be found through nature. And then I started getting a little bit closer to the light, and it was just an ecstatic, joyful feeling. You know, like, oh, like I'd been there before. I knew it. And I knew it in childhood. So the closer I got, I was probably like 4 or 5 at that moment. I knew that if I kept going, I wouldn't want to come back. And at that moment, I felt a wind. And this wind, there were several different elements to the wind, but I felt as if it was people's prayers. And I felt it as my grandmother and my mother and different people. And I felt this wind encircle my body and start pulling me away from the light. And so at the same time, I was 5, but I was growing up quickly. It was like I was becoming my older self again. And so the wind pulled me back. And as I was leaving, I still saw the green pastures, which are far more green than any green I've seen before, as if it was pure. There was no element to these green pastures that were tainted in any way, as was the sky and the world itself, as if maybe a world without pollution, perhaps. But as I was coming back, then again I went farther up, and I was looking down at this green pasture, and there were lots of lights, and I saw these lights as students, and I knew that these would be people that would come into my life, and people that I would tell this story to as well. So initially, they would be students, and then I just saw all these lights, which were represented as spirits, and they needed to be reminded of life after death, and that was part of my journey, was to remind people to perhaps live less selfishly too. You know, that if I could remind people at that age, you know, at junior high and high school, then perhaps maybe they wouldn't go to college and live the way I lived those 4 years, that they might be thinking a bit more beyond themselves. And so that was part of what I felt my purpose was, at least at that moment, that teaching was definitely tied to my life path. And so then I returned to my body, and then it happened quickly. I think the last thing I remember was really the wind and a lot of movement, and it was fast, and then things became dark, and then I was in my body.
Whenever I hear Tricia talk about the lights she saw, first it was students, and then it was other people telling about her experience, I often wonder if she saw you, hearing about her experience. Yeah. So a couple things about her experience to highlight. One is when she was in the operating room, out of her body, seeing these two beings, which she now calls angels. I've kept in touch with Tricia. I just saw her a couple of weeks ago. And she now refers to those beings as angels. Her experience illustrates the interweaving of the material and the transmaterial domain, because these beings, which clearly were not material, were there in the operating room, and in Tricia's perception, they sent light into the surgeons that moved through their bodies, down their fingertips, into her body, filled her body, and she knew that that was the healing light. And so the transmaterial interacted with the material. So the division between non-material, material, and transmaterial is kind of artificial. Another thing, I always tease Tricia that she got career counseling in her NDE, because before she was thinking, I don't know, I'm good in English, maybe I'll be a copy editor. She learned that she would be a teacher, and she has all these years been a community college English teacher. And in that work, she not only helps the students with English, but she helps them with life purpose. And so she's just in the most perfect place for herself and all the students who've benefited from her. So is there anything you want to ask about her, about what you've heard so far from Tricia? Because we're going to hear a little bit more about her NDE, a couple more excerpts. But any questions? Okay, let's move on then and hear a little bit more. This is about speed. And also, I forgot to mention, one of the things NDEers say is when they are just trying to talk about their NDE, that words do not capture their experience. Language was designed to navigate this reality, not that reality. And so language fails people. And so the technical word for this is that the experience is ineffable. It's impossible to describe in human language. So you'll hear her talk about that.
I didn't want to look at certain things, so if my mind decided that I didn't want to look at something, then I didn't have to. And so it was almost as if there was a choice, just like once I was leaving the room, that could happen quicker than one would imagine, just like you imagine yourself out of the room, and then you're out of the room. And so I guess the main thing is that things happen at a faster speed, and that, yeah, you don't experience life in the same way that we do within a body. There's less limits.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like although all these things were happening at once, that you didn't feel overwhelmed.
No, in fact, I felt like I was ready to experience more and more. So even though things were happening at a fast rate, I was comparing it to life inside a body, and I knew that it was faster, but I also knew it could be much faster, you know, that I could still learn more, could still receive more information. I just might not know, and I still don't know how to translate some things that happened from the other side into words and explain that here. And that might be a lifelong journey, you know. Or it might just be a feeling, and that a piece of
I find it interesting that these many years later, she's still trying to figure out, am I ever going to be able to explain this, or am I just going to accept that it can't be explained? She's still kind of struggling with that. Okay, and here she talks about, I also don't know if I emphasized enough that NDEers are absolutely clear that what they experienced was real. And I remember when I was doing my doctoral dissertation research, it was a male questionnaire, and I'm sitting reading this guy's answers to my questions, and one of the questions was, if someone had approached you after your NDE to talk with you about the extent to which it felt real, would you be willing to talk with them? Because I was interested to know how open are NDEers to being interviewed. And his response was, that's fine, they can come, but I can tell you something. That experience was realer than sitting here writing this answer to you. And I still get chills when I think about that answer. It's realer than real. It's a very common thing that NDEers say. So here's Tricia talking about that topic.
A lot of times people ask me afterwards, that's real. Well, it was more real than this real. So as we're sitting here having coffee, right now I know that there could be angels all around us. There could be something that we don't see right now. And this is less real than that experience. And that's, I think, what has stayed with me, more real than any dream. Because there was an element of this reality that I know is reality, plus another reality.
And I think that's it. So before we move on to after effects, is there anything you want to ask about the experience itself? Anything you've heard or read or just wondered about? Yeah.
Has anyone ever professed scorn towards other NDEers in terms of when they recount angels, etc.?
Are you asking if NDEers?
No.
Or other people?
Other
yes,
people.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. People encounter a lot of discrimination when they talk about their NDEs. Because again, first of all, our culture does not prepare us for these experiences even exist. And because the experiences involve things that are transmaterial, even despite the fact that religions address transmaterial domains and things like that, this is much more detailed, and we just aren't prepared for it. And so there's a lot of misunderstanding. And I've done a lot of research about disclosure of near-death experiences, especially to healthcare providers. And what makes the difference between a positive and negative disclosure experience is whether the confidant, the person to whom the NDEer is disclosing their NDE, responds with, first of all, recognizing that what the person's talking about is an NDE, and being able to say, you know, I don't know if you realize, but you had something that actually has a name. It's a thing. Mm-hmm. It's a known thing. It's called a near-death experience. If the confidant either believed that the experience was real or was open to the possibility that the experience was real, if they dismiss it, then that's going to be a problem for the near-death experiencer. If the confidant avoids pathologizing, like there, as you'll see shortly, there's no relationship between NDEs and mental illness. But because, again, this people are talking about transmaterial domains and things like that, some people mistake a transcendent experience for being a pathological experience. And so people get misdiagnosed. And I actually know people who were diagnosed with psychiatric diagnosis purely on the basis of a near-death experience that they absolutely didn't deserve it. In fact, one of them was a good friend of mine who had a drowning near-death experience at the age of 5, not unlike Audrey. And she had to go to all kinds of trouble to get that removed from her record. That's a problem. And then the last thing is that the confidant avoids demonizing the experience because, again, in some especially conservative religious worldviews, experiences like this, if Jesus isn't in there, then it's of the devil and it's evil and the individual is evil for having had it. And so people can be traumatized by that kind of response as well. So we'll, Stathi is going to talk later about the helpful ways to respond when people disclose a near-death experience. Yeah, anything else about the experience itself? Okay, after effects. So I like to categorize them as psychological, spiritual, physical, and social. So the psychological after effects include, first of all, the loss of fear of death. Virtually everybody who's had a near-death experience absolutely knows that consciousness continues after physical death. Profound shifts in fundamental values. People become less materialistic, more concerned about others, more interested in purpose in life and finding and fulfilling their purpose in life, and those kinds of value shifts. And increased self-worth and that meaning and sense of purpose in life. This is kind of a paradoxical one because at the same time that people are absolutely humbled by the experience, they also have the sense of having been in the light, absolutely known, absolutely loved. There is nothing not to love about oneself. So their self-concept, their self-worth increases exponentially at the same time that they're very humbled by the experience. And spiritual after effects include a deeper religious or spiritual faith. Usually spiritual, there's a tendency for people to move away from organized religion to become spiritual but not religious, just because religion isn't big enough to account for what they experienced. But some people do become more involved in their religion. I have a very good friend who had a near-death experience when he was in his 20s, an allergic reaction to penicillin. And just a couple years ago, he was ordained in the Catholic Church as a, what's the lay person in the Catholic Church? Does anybody know?
Deacon?
A deacon. Thank you. Yeah, he was ordained as a deacon. So he's an example of someone who's become very... Of course, I was there that weekend of his ordination, and he gave his first homily on Sunday. It was about near-death experiences. So, you know, yeah. Other things that might be categorized in the spiritual domain is that people become more psychic, like Audrey described, being prescient, knowing things that are going to happen, knowing what people are experiencing, being sensitive to other people's medical conditions. So those kinds of psychic abilities. And physical after effects include changed bodily functions. Audrey mentioned needing less sleep. People have changes in their diets. Some people become vegetarian or vegan. On the other hand, my friend Linda, who had the drowning NDE at age 5, she has to have meat every day. So there isn't a one-size-fits-all after effect, except that people do attribute these changes to the NDE itself. People also often experience malfunction of electronic devices in their vicinity, and Audrey mentioned that you can't keep a watch going. When I go to the IANS, the International Association for Near-Death Studies annual conference, if I meet a stranger, I glance down at their wrist, and that tells me whether they're an NDEer or whether they're like a researcher, educator, healthcare provider, because the NDEers just can't keep a watch going. My friend Linda, who had the drowning NDE at age 5, her boyfriend found a watch for her that the battery gets recharged by light, and that's the only one she can wear. And I just think that that's so interesting, light. Which is such a pervasive thing in near-death experiences.
That's the kind of watch I have.
Pardon me?
That's the kind of watch I have.
Okay, there you go. And then you can imagine if a person's fundamental values are changed, the way they function physically, the way they believe spiritually and experience spiritually, it's bound to have social effects. And so people do have relationship stress. They change friends and other kinds of social, change jobs, changing towards service-oriented careers. And we also know that one of my doctoral students did her dissertation on the effect of a near-death experience on a person, on a marriage, if a person is married at the time of their NDE. Because it had been kind of observed that there seemed to be sort of a high divorce rate after near-death experiences, and her research confirmed that. And furthermore, identified the dynamics of that, and it has to do with that value shift. So what we know is that people who get married tend to have similar values. So here are the people chugging along in life with their similar values. Then one of them has an NDE. If they become less materialistic, more concerned about service to others, you know, these are not predominant values in our culture, so they diverge value-wise, and they're likely to divorce. She found a couple of couples who reported that their marriages were better than ever since the person's NDE. And what she found was this person, the other person, already had NDE-like values. So they were similar, but when this person had the NDE, they actually got closer. They and their values converged, and their marriage continued better than ever. So it all has to do, seemingly, with the values shift that occurs following NDEs. So here's Tricia talking about some after effects. First of all, her disappointment at being re-embodied. Oops. Let's try that again.
My body, the next thing I recalled was being awoken and that I could fix. And the woman was asking, or the nurse was asking me if I remembered my name. And I told her I remember her name, and she said, we know your name. And I remember thinking, oh no, here I am, back in this, you know, this being, and I have to be this person instead of all of expansion was much more fun than being one person with one particular path and one particular time. And so there was a bit of disappointment initially in returning. And then I kind of wondered if I was going to be the same person at all, you know, if I would return to any of those patterns, because I felt, well, I could change everything, you know, I could be a completely different person. However, that didn't happen. I think the people around us remind us of who we are, too, and they want us to stay, you know, for their comfort and their sake, at least a little bit closer to who we are. But I would never remain exactly the same.
Okay. And spiritual focus and spiritual ramifications?
Yeah, your friends and family members, they can. Especially my friends in adjustment period, some did leave my life, other new ones came in immediately, but some people have stayed from that time forward, and I don't think that they liked me that much right after my accident. They thought I was a bit of a downer because I wouldn't talk about God or the light or, you know, things that 21-year-olds, you know, would rather go, hey, let's have a drink and, you know, like, talk about, you know, relationships or talk about or talk about plans, and I was much more philosophically concerned. And so some of my new friendships with people were older than me, and meditation groups and yoga groups, and so I definitely was gravitating towards more metaphysical knowledge.
And loss of self-centeredness?
Before my accident, I was definitely afraid to talk in front of crowds. After my accident, all of that fear had evaporated because I knew that what I had to say was important, and I knew that it was that I had to stand in front of people and talk, and that it wasn't so much about me, it was more about the message. And so for the first time, I was disconnected from, oh, what are they thinking about me? And then, oddly, you're more successful that way because you're not self-conscious in a sense, and you do realize that I'm here for you, not for me.
Social and psychic boundary challenges.
So I can say that when I was closer to the NDE, I was very almost innocent and childlike. Like, I saw the beauty in every person that I encountered. And then, like a child, I kind of have grown up in a sense, since then, hardening myself to, you know, not letting people in so easily, you know, and being more discriminatory about who it is that I'm going to get close to. And what has not changed, though, is teaching is still a joy, you know, that I still feel that no matter how complicated or strange my life may be at times, teaching is always and it always works, and it is definitely where I feel most centered and at home and at peace is working with other people. And I could not have imagined myself in that way before the accident. I think that I would have been a horrible teacher because I would have been totally self-absorbed instead of, you know, truly concerned about other people's lives. And I'll go back a bit. You know, the first couple of years after the accident, I said I joined, you know, a meditation group, and I sought out people who may have more of a focus, a spiritual focus. And so I went to hear shamans speak, and I went and I was searching. And then it was like, I kind of hoped. I read Carlos Castaneda's books, and I hoped that I might have some type of mentor that would guide me through this practice. And I had a few psychic experiences that I didn't know how to handle, and so I asked that they go away because I couldn't handle them. I thought, you know, I just want to finish my studies, I want to be a little bit more grounded. I just didn't have the tools really to deal with that amount of information. I thought, well, it would have been great to have had someone to guide me, but I didn't find anyone. And so a lot of that shut down. And there's been times in my life when I thought, okay, I'm ready for it to open up a bit more. And yet, it has come through dreams. So my dreams at night, and that seems to be the way I can handle it, but sometimes I know what might happen the next day, or if something is looming in the future that is negative, then I'm a little bit more prepared for it. And that is fake. I mean, that did not happen to me as a child or before, but indeed.
And I think this is the last one, change in religious affiliation.
What I'm thinking is when I talk about spiritualism, I am simply meaning that there is a knowing, or there is so much beyond what we know in our lives that I don't think any particular one religion or any particular one book or any explanation can explain what it is that I experienced and what is out there. And so I just believe that there is a greater knowing and a greater knowledge. And I feel more comfortable in places like the Unitarian Church that accepts many belief systems. But yet, I don't even really hate the Unitarian Church either. I don't think that, I mean, wherever there is love, wherever there is light, I think that that's important. I've been to a Catholic church with my grandmother and thought this one particular priest was just filled with the light. And thought, oh, how beautiful. I'm not Catholic, I don't want to come here, but I think he's a good person. And, you know, I've been to various churches and the temples in Korea, and I thought, oh, well, this particular monk is very spiritual, very connected. And so I think that same light is in that monk that's in the priest. And so some churches are light-filled and beautiful, and others are really not all that light-filled and not that great of an experience. And so to me, churches are just places to experience the light, but you can also experience it in meditation.
So before we go on, any questions about after effects?
Yes, I have a question. Have you, from their research, have there been reports of them trying to die again to feel that experience?
That's a great question. So let me start by saying, it is not uncommon for NDEers to talk about a profound sense of longing to be back in that very pleasurable experience. The vast majority of NDEers would never dream of committing suicide, because the other thing they get from the NDE is a sense, a very clear sense that their life has purpose. Mm-hmm. They're here for a reason, and to abort that purpose would be, you know, just to defeat themselves. I've heard more than one NDEer say, if I killed myself, I'd just come back and have to start over where I left off, you know, so why not keep going? And but there have been a couple of cases of people who are suspected of having killed themselves to return to that state, but it's very, very rare. Yeah, and you know, this is a very tricky subject, because what NDEers say about suicide is that there is no judgment, like we have, you know, in religious and social circles here. But at the same time, it isn't taking away the judgment, doesn't take away their motivation not to kill themselves. So in other words, they retain, even stronger than the fact that, you know, they wouldn't be judged, is the sense that they're here for a reason, and that this is a earthly existence is a unique opportunity to grow in particular ways spiritually. And we just do ourselves a tremendous disservice to waste the opportunity. Anything else? After effects?
Yeah, have you ever had someone say that they're hypersensitive to all forms of medication after?
Yes.
That's me.
Yes. Medication, sometimes people say that they take one-tenth the dose that they used to take, and it still feels like too much. And people have allergies, new allergies to different foods and medications, and some people have chemical sensitivity in general, and so that they attribute to their NDE. Anything else? Okay, it's kind of warm in here, right? Yeah. What would you think about just standing up for 30 seconds and getting your blood flowing again? And Stati, could we open the door and get some food? Come on.
for a bit because otherwise the sound.
Yeah, I know, right. But we'll just get a little bit of cool air.
You were talking about medication. They do a lot of reading.
We are pretty hot here.
Biology.
So far, we've been talking about pleasurable NDEs. So these are experiences that are dominated by feelings like peace, joy, and love. There are also distressing NDEs that are dominated by terror, horror, guilt, other kinds of despair, other kinds of negative experiences. As far as we can tell, they constitute maybe 10% of NDEs, maybe not that much, but we can't tell for sure because people do seem to be more reluctant to talk about these experiences than pleasurable ones. So I'll just tell you about the four types that appear to have to exist. The most commonly reported has all the same features as a pleasurable NDE, except apparently the person was kind of resisting it, and the resistance is what created the negative feelings. So they're moving rapidly through a tunnel toward a light, but they don't want to be. It's like they've got their, you know, their heels dug in, and that resistance seems to make the experience negative. Once there were some cases where people were in the midst of a distressing NDE and they just decided to surrender or to ask for help, and the NDE shifted to pleasurable. So it seems like there can be something about attitude and that sort of thing that influences. Next most commonly reported is a person being in an absolute eternal void. And it's maybe hard to imagine the sense that one is absolutely alone and will be so forever. So it's a particular kind of hell. And early in my research career, I met a man who had one of these experiences. He had been, first of all, he had grown up in a very abusive home. And so his way of surviving was to try to just be invisible and be left alone so that if he didn't come to his father's attention, he wouldn't get beaten. And so he took that mode of operation into life, and just in general, he sought to be left alone. Well, also because his trust in people was, you know, very low. And so he became a stained glass artist, so he worked alone in a studio doing stained glass work. And one day he had a medical crisis, he had a near-death experience, and he found himself out in a void, absolutely alone forever. And that experience seemed to last forever, and then it ended when he was resuscitated. And for the first couple years, he really wondered, like, what was that about and why did he have that experience? And the more he reflected on it, the more he realized that in his NDE, he had gotten what he always wanted in life, to be left alone. And it was only in the experience of being left completely alone forever that he realized that that wasn't really what he wanted. What he wanted was safe connection with benevolence. And so when he came back, he changed his whole way of being. Instead of thinking everybody's down at this end of the continuum, not trustworthy, he began to discern. Some people are more trustworthy than others. And to those people, he learned how to open himself and really create connections, which he just hadn't done for the first 30 years of his life. So he believed, and distressing NDEers in general show that although initially they're more traumatized, eventually they show the same after effects as pleasurable NDEers, and they tend to come to see their distressing NDE as a blessing in disguise that in many cases created for them a kind of spiritual course correction, and that's what they needed in order to make that course correction. So so that's one kind. Next, most often, like, and only extremely rarely do people report some kind of torment. And I've only heard one case where a person experienced like hellfire and brimstone type torment. more often it's of a different type. For example, Matthew Davel, who is, he's spoken publicly about his near-death experience. This experience he had as a result of suicide. However, don't think that suicide and distressing NDEs are connected, because they're not. But he has happened to be during from a suicide attempt. And at one point in his NDE, I won't tell you the whole thing, it was more complex than this, but he was free-falling, which was a horrible feeling in itself, not knowing where he was going. He ended up on what he said was sort of like the clay surface of a tennis court, at which point when he hit, he split into seven hymns. So there was the hymn that was over here in anguish about what was happening to the other six hymns. And then there were two, two, and two. And these two hymns were experiencing, first of all, people from his past who he had hurt. They would appear one at a time, approach him, bump his chest, which is where the heart chakra is, and then he would relive the experience knowing the pain that he had engendered in them. And these people appeared one after another and another. And he said, you'd think it would be important people like my wife, you know, but he said, no, like one of them was this grocery clerk that he had like a 45-second interaction with, but he was so nasty to her, he experienced the effect on her, and then that it put her in a bad mood, and the effect it had on all the other people that she saw for a while after in the grocery line. So anyway, then two that were of hymns that were experiencing people from the present, his present life, and then two that were experiencing things from the future. So at the time that he attempted suicide, he had an infant daughter. In this one, he saw his daughter on her high school graduation day, sitting in her bedroom crying, because here again was another important event in her life, and her father wasn't there to share it because he killed himself when she was a baby. So so he said that this went on, one person after another appearing like this, for what he experienced is 3 days and three nights. And at one point, the hymn that was over here now, just weeping in anguish, remembered a previous near-death experience he'd had as a preteen, drowning, in fact. He was impressing girls, and he thought he would, you know, do the whole length of the pool underwater. When he got to the other side, his friends thought it would be fun, and they pushed him, kept him underwater with their feet, pushed him down. So he drowned, he sank to the bottom, had this near-death experience in which he met Jesus. And Jesus, among other things, told him that he had work to do. And he's like, what? You know, he's like an 11-year-old kid. He doesn't get what this is about at all. So anyway, fast forward, the suicide, which was not an attempt to get back to the pleasure. As a result of his first NDE, all the after effects, nobody to help him cope with it, the only way he could quiet, like the psychic ability and all that stuff, was to do drugs. By the time he got to be in his middle 20s with a wife and infant child, he had what he said was a $1,000 a week drug habit, and he thought he was no earthly good to anybody and he would just kill himself. So there he is in the NDE, weeping in anguish. He remembers his NDE, he calls out to Jesus, he reports that the sky kind of opened up and this hand came down and grabbed him, and the minute he left that surface, all seven of him went into one, he was pulled out, he had another heart-to-heart with Jesus. Jesus had again told him he had work to do. Now as a 20-something-year-old, he kind of got what that might be about, and ever since he's never done drugs again, and he has been the president of a nonprofit suicide prevention organization. So he got the message finally. But you see that what he went through was a hellish kind of torment, but it was actually a kind of a life review sort of thing that just was really
bad. Do you see any difference of people that have the experience, that have younger children, like people that depend on them, if they have different experience?
Yeah, so the question is whether people have a different experience if they have younger children still alive. And I won't say there's a difference in the experience, But one of the things I didn't talk about in the experience itself, how it ends. About half of people, just the experience ends. They're tooling along, and in the NDE, and it's just like when Stathi said, you know, freeze, everything just stopped, and they're back in their body. But the other half of people, and among that other 50% are people who say they don't have a choice. They're told they're going to return, and no matter how much they might argue, like there's this one gal, Kimberly Clark Sharp, she said she argued with God, and God said, you're going to go back, and she said, no, I'm not. And he said, yes, you are. She's like, no, I'm not. And she says, you see who won. So, but some people, the other 50%, have a choice about whether they're going to return. And when they choose to return, there is not a case. My doctoral student, Roseanne Christian, has read every journal article and study that's ever been published on near-death experiences. She said she's never read a case where this wasn't the case, that the person's in their NDE, and they either are told explicitly that they have a choice, or they just have a sense that it's kind of time to decide if I'm going to go back or not. And in the process, they think about a living person with whom they have a love connection, and often it is a child, and how that person's life will be hurt if the NDEer doesn't go back to life. And it's not like they think that and then they think, well, I guess I better go back. They think that and they're back. The moment they empathize with someone who needs them in physical existence, they're back in their body. So that love connection is a very important factor in people returning to existence according to their memory of their NDE. And there was one case in which a person felt condemned in their NDE. So it's just very, very, very rare. So as I mentioned, in research, the incidence ranges from 0 to 50%, but overall, 10% or maybe less. And and there's no clear difference. So one of the things that, well, we're going to get to this here in, actually, I think the next slide, but all the research that we've done, we can't tell, out of all the people who survive a close brush with death, 4 out of 5 will remember nothing unusual, 1 out of 5 will remember an NDE. We can't tell any difference between those people. Then, out of all the people who remember an NDE, 90% remember a pleasurable one, 10% remember a distressing one. We can't tell any difference between them. So NDEs seem to be equal opportunity experiences that we don't really know from research why they happen or the types happen. And my answer, my personal opinion answer is heaven only knows. That there's some spiritual reason why some people have NDEs and others don't, that's beyond human reasoning. So, children. Children and teens of all ages have reported NDEs. Their NDEs are similar to adults in content and after effects. And their testimonies can be particularly poignant. So how much do we can keep going a little bit? Okay. So I want to read this one to you because I like this. This is very touching. This is from the Handbook of Near-Death Experiences. Sherry Sutherland wrote the chapter on children's NDEs. Erin was 10 years old when I first met her, just 12 months after her NDE. At that point, she still showed some physical signs of the brain damage she'd sustained as a result of a cardiopulmonary arrest during an acute asthma attack. These disabilities included a slight Parkinsonian disorder, limited use of her left hand, and difficulty with walking. Erin had the luminescence I often observed in child NDEers, and I found her to be extremely intelligent and highly articulate. According to her father, Erin had been clinically dead for perhaps 3 minutes, and after a critical period of about 5 days, she finally came to, blind and with no movement at all. It was some months after this episode that Erin first spoke about her NDE. Her father said at the time that it was a humbling experience to be given, quote, the most believable description of life after death, unquote, by his daughter, a child of 9 years of age. And then Sherry goes on to say, I met with Erin and her parents 3 times over a 6-month period. On that last visit, I found the level of her recovery astonishing, and as she and I sat together on her bedroom floor, she was even more full of fun and good humor than usual while drawing what she had seen during her experience. On all 3 occasions, I found her story to be consistent. She said, when I was in the ambulance, I was looking down at myself and thinking, oh my God, what's going on? And then I was on top of the ceiling looking down at myself thinking, oh, this is radical. And then all of a sudden I saw my mom and dad. They were crying their eyes out. Then something pulled me through the ceiling and I was flying down this cloudy white tunnel. Then I saw this beautiful, magnificent light and I stopped there. It was so nice and peaceful. And then somebody spoke to me and it was a familiar voice. It was Vanessa, one of my best friends who had passed away. She had light around her and she looked quite pretty. And then I saw God. He was standing in a light. Boy, was he good. God had a body, but he wasn't male or female, and he had like billions and millions and millions and trillions and billions of heads, all the heads of the whole galaxy. I was searching around to find my head, but my head wasn't there. It must pop off when you die. Then God gave me 3 choices, to get reborn, or to stay in heaven, or he said I could go back to my body, but my body would be damaged and I would have to fight. I chose to fight. Bad choice. I'm full up with all these memories. I saw Jesus too, and whenever you see pictures of him, you get really fed up because that's not what he looks like. There were millions of people there. There were the reincarnating line, there was the staying line, and I was right there on the fighting line. It was spooky. I've been trying to block it out of my mind, but this is the toughest bit. When I had to fight, the devils had weapons, and I didn't. And Sherry says, how did you fight then? And Sherry says, she looked astonished that I could be so ignorant. And Erin said, with my heart. So that's how we fight the devils, with our heart. So, whereas adults often struggle with their after effects, children maybe even more because of their developmental level and so forth, they may need even more help than adults do. So, here's the bottom line of this slide. NDEs are an equal opportunity transpersonal experience. Any demographic you can think of, you were an assassin, sexual orientation, you had an abortion, there's no difference between people who do and don't have NDEs, and there's no difference in the quality of the nature of the NDE, whether it's pleasurable or distressing. So it's not that bad people have bad NDEs, it's not like that at all. So we just don't really know. And everyone who's ever researched distressing NDEs has concluded that, as far as they can tell, anybody could have a distressing NDE. I tend to think that distressing NDEs have a good deal, maybe not entirely, to do with the mindset of the person during the time that they're having the near-death episode. And so that's what makes the experience so plastic, that if the person kind of adjusts their attitude, they might be able to change a distressing experience into a pleasurable one. So, non-Western near-death experiences. This is another quick slide. Jeff Long did an analysis of thousands of NDEs that have been registered at the Near-Death Experience Research Foundation website that he and his wife Jody direct. And he found that NDEs are universal, the contents and after effects, no consistent difference between NDEs of people from various cultures. And this has brought me to what I call the faces analogy. So NDEs are like faces. If you think about faces all around the world, there's certain universal deep structure similarities. You've got 2 eyes and a nose and a mouth in particular relationship to each other. Then if you go to areas of the world, you get racial or cultural influences. You know, an Asian face is going to look different than a Caucasian or an African-American face. And even within any, like African-American, there is uniqueness between the faces. And NDEs are just like that. There are some universal features that fit with all NDEs. There are cultural factors. People will describe their NDEs in the terms of their own culture, their own language. That probably has less to do with the NDE than it does just that culture limits the ways that we can talk about things. And then there are individual features to every NDE. No two NDEs are alike. So so there's the universal, the cultural, and the individual layers of the contents of NDEs.
So,